Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another webinar at the National Library of Scotland. My name is Kenny Redpath and I'm the events officer at the library. As you know, it's Halloween this weekend, and although we're being asked not to go guising over the weekend, we thought that it might be a nice idea to tie in a couple of events with Halloween in mind. And witches certainly seem to have proved a very popular topic to have chosen. We have today 500 people, which is a sold out event, booked for today's event, with countries as far away as United States, India, South Korea and Argentina, to name but a few, joining us this afternoon. We're really excited to be reaching out to all of you. I just hope you're enjoying what the library is doing as much as we are putting everything on. This afternoon, I'm delighted to introduce Mary C. Craig, who is here to talk about her new book, Borders Witch Hunt, 17th Century Witchcraft Trials in the Scottish Borders. Mary is a writer and historian living and working in Scotland. She is a former Carnegie Scholar and a graduate of the University of Glasgow. It is said that there are three types of historians. Some historians are hedgehogs, half-play snuffling about rooting out the minutest of historical details. Others are eagles soaring on high, and they see the great vistas of historical events. Mary is a magpie. If something shiny and interesting catches her eye, she will try to capture it where possible. Her main focus in writing is to explore the lives of extraordinary people who lived through extraordinary times and to bring to life the history of Europe in all its vivid colours. So looking forward to this event. Over to you, Mary.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and I hope you can all hear me and see me clearly. I'm sure I'll get a message from Kenny if I've not pressed all the right buttons. So, yes, witches. When I was little, I grew up in Glasgow, and I would go out guising, and I would always dress up as a witch. Great fun. I would have the pointy hat and the broomstick. I would fly about my broomstick, and I would have a black cat, and I would go out guising because witches were great fun. And then I got a little bit older, went to university to discover that witches in Scotland didn't really have pointy hats. They may have had broomsticks, but they just used them to sweep the floor like anybody else. And they didn't particularly have cats, and they certainly didn't fly about on broomsticks. So that was interesting. And the more I started to look at it, the more I realised I knew nothing about witches. And then I stumbled upon the fact that in Scotland it was the 17th century when you tended to have the most witchcraft trials, which I found very odd because when I was small I thought witches were from, you know, the olden days, and the 17th century didn't seem to be that long ago. So that intrigued me, and then I looked at the numbers and I realised that although obviously there were lots of witchcraft trials up in Edinburgh with it being the capital, most of them were down in the borders. And again, I wasn't quite sure why there should be more in the borders than, say, in Glasgow, where there were more people, or somewhere like Stirling or Dundee or Aberdeen. And so I started to really get involved and really sort of started to unearth what was happening with witchcraft. And what I found was amazing, unsettling, and very, very strange. Because most of it is actually really mundane, and yet that becomes very murderous. So the 17th century is a strange century. Like all good history stories, to start somewhere, you have to go back 50 years. So we go back to around about the middle of the 16th century. Scotland was a Catholic country, like most of Western Europe. Then the Reformation comes along, and the Reformation, you know, tries to reform the Catholic Church, and there are all these amazing discussions with all these different people, Martin Luther, and eventually Scotland becomes a Protestant country, but not just a Protestant country, a Calvinist country. So we were the best of the best. Oh, absolutely, we were the best. And that was fine. And by about the beginning of the 17th century, we had sort of settled into being a Protestant church. But the trouble was, there were still Catholics. And the way the Reformation had happened, everybody was sitting in their camps. If you were a Protestant, then the Catholics thought you were all pagan heathens and wicked people. And if you were a Protestant, you thought the Catholics were all following the devil and being horrible. If there had been Twitter in the day, they'd have been yelling at each other on Twitter. But anyway, so that's two camps. So the Church of Scotland sitting, the Kirk sitting at the beginning of the 17th century, and there are still some of those Catholics hanging about, which is a little bit scary. And then, of course, a perfect storm was created at the beginning of that century. There was 2 or 3 years where the harvest failed and there was famine. Now, this was across Northern Europe into Britain, but it was quite localised in the borders. There were a couple of really bad famines in the border. Then there were a couple of series of disease outbreaks. We're not quite sure what, but it was like the plague. Who knew what it was? It didn't matter. You were dying anyway. And then across in the continent, round about 1618, the 30 Years' War pitches up, where the Catholics and the Protestants are fighting each other. And across the border from the borders in the north of England, well, they weren't really quite Protestant like us. They were sort of Anglicans, and maybe some of them, the Percys and the Nevilles, were actually still Catholics. And there were those scary Catholics across in Ireland. So all of these things come together to create this perfect storm of fear and anxiety. And the Kirk, which is a new Kirk, is establishing itself with all of these things bubbling away in the background. Now, the other issue with us being Calvinist, it meant that we thought we were perfect. Well, of course, we were Scottish. We were perfect. We were God's elect. Who does the devil attack? Does he attack his own? Does he attack his friends? No, of course not. He attacks the people that are the most godly. And so the church starts to think, well, we need to be careful here because the devil, old Nick, might start roaming about and trying to attack us. And then, of course, all these things that were bubbling in the background started to prove this point. Because if you've got war and you've got famine and you've got plague and you've got death, what's that but the four horsemen of the apocalypse? And if you've got the four horsemen of the apocalypse, then yes, old Nick is out. He is out abroad trying to snatch your soul. And who works with him? Witches, his handmaidens. So that's the background you've got. And then there was one final thing that tipped it over the edge for Scotland. Queen Elizabeth I of England died. Old Queen Bess in 1603 dies, and King James VI of Scotland becomes James I of England. And he got his fat backside onto a horse and ran down to London as quickly as he could, because that was where the money was. Scotland was a very poor country at the time. He goes all the way down to England, but he takes the nobility and he takes the aristocracy with him. So there's a power vacuum in Scotland, and the only organisation there is to step up to the mark, as it were, was the Kirk. So you have a country that's got war on its doorstep and Catholics on its doorstep and famine and plague and death and no king, no nobility, and you've got the Kirk. And the Kirk is telling you that we're great, we're Scottish, we're fantastic, we are the best of the best, but because of that, old Nick will come out and he'll attack us. So be on your guard for him and be on your guard for witches. So all of that's bubbling away, bubbling away, bubbling away in the background. So in Scots law at that time, there were four proofs for being a witch. One was obviously if you confessed to being a witch. Well, if you say you're a witch, you're a witch. Secondly was if another witch called you a witch. That was called being delated, if you were delated as a witch. The third one was being found with the devil's mark on you. It was thought that if you followed the devil, he would mark you in some way and there might be some mark on your body that can be seen. But the fourth proof, and the one that tripped everybody up, remember what I was saying about it being mundane, was having a bad reputation. Now, if I go to my local supermarket, buy a loaf of bread, bring it home and it's mouldy, I go back and they say, oh, terribly sorry, here's your money back. But if I go to the market in Selkirk and I say, that bread's mouldy, I want my money back, the local baker's not going to agree with me because his reputation's on the line. He's going to say, no, no, my bread. But everybody's in the marketplace and everybody can see me arguing, being quarrelsome. If I go to the supermarket here and have an argument with my husband in the frozen food aisle, people will just probably laugh and walk past me. But again, in the marketplace in Hoyk or Gala Shields, oh look, there's that Mary arguing again. If I don't go to the kirk on Sunday here, the minister might come and see me a few days later and say, oh Mary, were you not very well on Sunday? I didn't spot you in the church. If I don't go to the kirk in the 17th century, I'd better be on my deathbed because that's the only reason you've got to not be in the kirk. So if I'm not going to the kirk, if I'm arguing in the marketplace, maybe I've not got a husband. Oh, maybe he's dead. Did she kill him? Oh dear. And that reputation of being a quarrelsome dame is there. So people are already thinking, well, here's that Mary. She lives in the Borders, but she's actually from Glasgow. So, well, you know, she's a bit odd and she's a bit argumentative. So that sort of proof, if you like, is sitting there waiting to trip me up. So I'm walking down the road and I see my neighbour. And maybe I'm in a bad mood that day. Who knows? Whatever. And I give my neighbour a bit of a funny look. And then my neighbour trips and falls and sprains their ankle. And they go home and they think about it and think, well, I've walked up and down that path hundreds of times. I've never fallen over. But that Mary gave me a funny look. That's not so good. Or maybe I have an argument with my next door neighbour and her chickens stop laying their eggs. Again, we're back to mundane things, but mundane things that matter. If you don't have eggs to sell in market, you don't have money to buy food for your family. There is no welfare state. You can starve to death over a Borders winter. So maybe I made your chicken stop laying your eggs. Now, initially, things like that happened all the time. And initially, it didn't really matter. But by the 17th century, every time you go to the kirk on a Sunday, the minister's telling you that Auld Nick's out there to get you. Every time you turn around, there's the harvest has failed, or there's bad weather, or there's plague, or you're hearing stories about the Catholics, or hearing stories about the war. And so you're being put under more and more and more pressure. And then your chickens stop laying, or your cow stops giving milk, and that's the final straw, and you can't take it anymore, and the word comes out which. And once that's out there, oh boy, that's it. The minister gets involved. And he comes up, who's a witch? And you say, that Mary, Mary's a witch. And the minister thinks, oh, that's right, because she wasn't at the kirk on Sunday. Oh yeah, and here she argues the marketplace quite a bit. I think we might have a witch. So the minister gathers together the elders of the church and they write up to the Privy Council in Edinburgh and they say, we think we've got a witch. Can we have a commission to try a witch? Now, this was a legal document that they had to have to mount an investigation into whether or not you were actually a witch. So they write up to Privy Council. Privy Council writes back and says, yep, go ahead. You've got basic proof. She's got quarrelsome nature. On you go. So the minister decides, I'm under investigation. So the minister starts to pull in every single friend, neighbour, anybody that lives in my neighbourhood and starts asking questions about me. Now, some people are going to be honest and say, oh, no, Mary's fine, she's okay. Some people might genuinely say things like, well, she did give me a funny look once and then I went home and I had a headache. And some people might be being malicious. Who knows? It doesn't actually matter because once that ball starts rolling, there is no stopping it. There is absolutely no stopping it. And eventually the minister will call me in for questioning. Now, the best method of questioning somebody then, and probably now, is what was known as walking and waking. So what they would do is they would keep you awake constantly for days on end. Being kept awake, sleep deprivation is so effective in making people confess that it's actually banned by the Geneva Convention to this day. You're not allowed to do it to people. To any of you who've got any kids, you can remember when the wee one was born and it was lovely and you're coming home from the hospital and, you know, all the grannies are coming round and, oh, look at the little fingernails and everything's lovely. And then 3 days later, you're so sleep deprived, you're putting your slippers in the microwave. That's what sleep deprivation does to you. So you are kept awake constantly. And then they did something called walking. So I'm little, I'm only 5'1". What they would do in the Borders is they get a couple of big rugby lads and they would walk me up and down and up and down and up and down for hours until I was exhausted and my feet are all swollen and pulpy. Then those two lads would go away and they'd bring in another two and they'd walk me up and down and up and down. And they would continue to do this constantly I'm being kept awake, I'm being driven to exhaustion. And the whole time this is happening, the minister's sitting there saying, you're a disgrace. Your immortal soul is in peril. You're going to hellfire and damnation. And that mattered then. Hell was a real, actual place you could be sent to. It wasn't like now where it might be a theological concept, or you might think, oh, well, hell's maybe like the withdrawal of God's grace. Hell was an actual place of torment that you could be sent. It was genuinely frightening. There was no question about belief in God. God existed. Heaven existed. Hell existed. So you're being roared at and yelled at and screamed at whilst you're being kept awake, whilst you're being forced to walk up and down and up and down until eventually I would crack. I would crack and say, yes, yes, I'm a witch. And that's it. You confess. So there's proof number two. You've named yourself as a witch. And then the questioning changes. Really interesting. If you get a chance after this talk, if you're interested, go and look at some of the trial records because they're fascinating to see how it was conducted. The Kirk was obsessed with Old Nick. They were obsessed with the devil. And so what they wanted to know everything about him. So they wouldn't say to me something like, okay, Mary, you've said you're a witch. Have you ever met the devil? They wouldn't ask that question because there was no point. Obviously, I had met the devil because I was one of his followers. It would be, when you met the devil, what did he look like? Or when you met the devil, what colour were his clothes? Or did you meet the devil in the guise of a big black dog? And these would be the questions they wanted to know. Then they would start, who else was there? Who else was there when you met the devil? Was your sister there? Was your daughter there? Was your mother there? Who else was there? What did you do? What did you promise the devil? And so they're gathering more material, more material, more material. But let's say you didn't confess. Let's say you were made of stronger stuff than me. I would probably have confessed within about 2 seconds, but let's say you were made of stronger stuff and you didn't confess, even though you've been kept awake, even though you've been walked, even though they've been yelling at you. You would send for the witch brother. Now, witch brothers were the official witch finders, if you like, in Scotland. There were about 10 or 12 of them, but the most famous one was John Kincaid, who came from Trinent up in East Lothian. And he had a warrant from the Privy Council to find witches by prodding them or pricking them. So what would happen is, you've refused to confess. Let's imagine I could have held out and I refused to confess. They would send up to John Kincaid and say, please come, we've got this witch from Glasgow, she won't confess, she's a horror, come down here and brood her for us. And so John Kincaid would turn up, be a big event, he comes up with him, and there's his horse, he's got a servant, and oh, yeah, it's a big event, and he's paid money, you have to pay him to do this. And the idea was that as Christ had laid his hands on his disciples, so the devil would lay his hands on me as a witch and he would mark me in some way, possibly on my head or my neck or my shoulders. And so as the devil was unnatural, so this mark would be unnatural and it wouldn't bleed, or if you pinched it, you wouldn't feel pain. So I would be brought forward, my hair would all be shaved off, my dress would be pulled down so that my shoulders were bare, and I'd be held by two Bailey men. And John Kincaid would come up and look over my body and he would maybe see a little mole or a freckle or a little mark that you had, maybe when your sister had mucked about and hit you or something in childhood. And he would take out a steel bodkin, that amount of a steel bodkin, walk forward and plunge it into that mark. And you cry out in pain, of course you do. And he would pull it back, okay, that wasn't the devil's mark. So he would look again, and again he would plunge it into the flesh. And he would keep going and going and going until he found a point where you didn't cry out in pain. Now, you might not be crying out in pain because you're lying on the floor unconscious, or you might not be crying out in pain because you are in such pain that you didn't actually feel that one. But there you go, the devil's mark is found, another proof. Now, there were some sheriffs and baileys that would examine witches without the use of John Kincaid for the devil's mark because they thought they could do it. And it would be noted down in the records that you had the devil's mark. And later on, if it went to trial, if you were then to say, oh, but I don't have the devil's mark. Look, there's no blemish on my shoulders. I'm fine. That didn't prove you were innocent. It actually just proved you were a very tricky witch and you were able to hide your devil's mark. So you're not going to make it out, are you? So you've got the quarrelsome nature. You've confessed to being a witch, maybe. You've got the devil's mark. But what about those other witches you named when you said that you'd supped with the devil? And I'd name my sister, my mother, my daughter, whatever. Those other witches are then brought in and they're put to the test. They're walked and they're kept awake and they're yelled at. And eventually they say, yeah, that means she's a witch as well. So there you go. There's your fourth proof. You've been delated. So that's it. Job done. And you're shoved in the toll booth while they decide to do a trial. Now, the problem with this is that Scotland at this time, very rural country, and the border's a very rural area. So if you were accused of witchcraft, say, beginning of the summer, nobody has got time to sit in a trial because there's work to be done. It's the rural summer. And so you could be in that cell until easily September or October. You're in a filthy cold cell, or if you're unlucky, a filthy hot cell. Either way, the cell is filthy. There's maybe some straw on the floor, if you're lucky. There will be fleas, there will be lice, there will be bed bugs, there will be cockroaches, there will be rats. You're probably getting to pee in a bucket. If you're lucky, you get a bucket. If not, tough. You're not really given anything much more than bread and water. Now, prisoners at that time were treated very, very badly, but witches were really treated badly. Now, the only way anybody's going to help you is by bringing food in, but nobody wants to be associated with a witch. So all of your family members, they've all gone, oh, nothing to do with us. No, 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 she's not really, oh, no, actually, well, she's not really my sister. She's only my half-sister. Or actually, oh, no, we found her and we just took her in. Nothing to do with us. So they're not helping. They're not bringing you in any food. If you've had any injury because of your treatment, like if your feet are, you may well have a lot of infections. Maybe you actually were so stubborn that they actually had to apply torture to you. And it did happen. Various tortures were used. They would put your feet on heated stones to burn the soles of your feet. Or they would get a thing called pillywinkles, which sounds really nice. Oh, the pillywinkles. It was the sort of Scottish version of thumb screws. And they would put them on your fingers and it would break your fingers. So that even if you weren't then sent to execution, your hands are crippled. You're in a rural area. You can't work. You could starve to death. A lot of people weren't tortured simply because the threat of torture was enough to make them confess. So you're lying in your cell, you are hungry, you're thirsty, you're covered in sores, you've got rats running all over the place, you are being told that you're going to hellfire and damnation, you haven't even got to the trial yet, okay, so all of these things are happening to you, and you're waiting, waiting, waiting for this trial. In the meantime, the minister, he's got a lot of work to do because he has to organise the trial. Now, before the 17th century, if you were guilty of a crime, you went through the criminal courts. And if you were guilty of something like blasphemy, you went through the church courts. And they were quite separate. But witchcraft was a very particular crime. It was a blasphemous crime. You were heretical. You were denying God, you were denying your baptism. But what you were doing affected people in the real world. So you were causing the harvest to fail, or you were causing somebody to die. You might have caused illness to a child. So the church court and the secular court had to come together. But because, as I said earlier, the king and the nobility, they've gone. The only authority is the church. The church was the lead in these court cases. So the local minister thinks, right, we need three or four commissioners, magistrates, judges, whatever you want to call them. There are no commissioners in Scotland. We need three or four of these to sit in judgment of that terrible Mary the Witch. And they need somebody they can trust. So you need somebody who's trustworthy, and you need somebody who's got, you know, a reasonable amount of status in the community, and somebody that would be willing to do it and has got the time to do it. So that would be maybe the local laird, who might well be the brother of the minister. But, you know, or the cousin of the minister, or the minister's best friend. So the minister has chosen the judges that are going to sit in judgment of you. Then you need your jurymen, 15 good men and true. Well, who knows who's of a good character? Because you have to have people of good character on the jury. You don't want just some anybody. So who knows who's of good character? The minister. So the minister chooses the jury that's sitting in your trial. There might be a prosecution advocate, or it might just be the minister himself who's prosecuting you. And there's no defence advocate. Because, first of all, well, why would you need one? Because it's obvious you're guilty. Because if you're not guilty, then the minister's guilty, and that doesn't make any sense. So, you know, what do you need a defence for anyway? Secondly, you can't afford a defence. And thirdly, since when did women get a defence in court? Don't be ridiculous, that's a silly one. So there's no defence for you. Women were not allowed to speak in court at this point, in a court trial. And then they discovered that one of the proofs being the fact that you were delated, remember being called a witch by another witch, you had to have that witch say, yes, that Mary's a witch. So what they did was they made a special amendment to the law that a witch, a woman, could give evidence in a witchcraft trial, but only if she was calling another witch a witch. So they made that little nice little get out of jail free card. Not for the witch, that was for sure. So after all these weeks in prison, you're exhausted, you're half dying and all the rest of it, finally the day of the trial turns up. Now the investigation to find out whether or not you were a witch in the first place may have taken a couple of weeks, 2 or 3 weeks maybe. You may have been in the troll booth in the jail for 2 or 3 weeks, sometimes 2 or 3 months. The trial could take as little as 2 or 3 hours, because you come up, the minister says to the commissioners, there's Mary Craig, she's a witch, and the reason I know she's a witch is she's argumentative and she doesn't come to the kirk on a Sunday, oh yeah, and she confessed and we found the devil's mark on her. And that's it, it's a done deal. So you're found guilty and you're sentenced to death. And that's it. Back you go to the troll booth. The jurymen, oh, thank you very much, off you go. The commissioners, the judges who sat, they get paid for their time, of course. And everybody's all very happy because that's it, you're going to be executed. So back I go to my cell. And that's it. I'm facing the death penalty. There is nothing else I can do. Or is there? And I do the one thing that a woman can do. I plead my belly. Because you can't execute me if I'm pregnant. So, am I pregnant? Yes, good, right, fine. Maybe somebody will rescue me. Maybe they'll change their mind. Maybe they'll just let me out. Maybe they'll be sick and tired of taking care of me in the troll booth and they'll just throw me out. Anything. You're fighting for your life at this point. You are literally clutching at straws. And so they don't execute you until you have the baby. But then you have the baby alone in a filthy, disgusting cell. And maybe you live, maybe you don't. Maybe the baby lives. But then they come and they take your baby away from you. And they give your baby to a local midwife. Because the church said that all foundlings were to be taken care of by the church. And so a local woman will be given your baby. And she'll be given a few pennies to take care of the baby. And at first that's great because, you know, the woman's taking care of the baby. And then it gets into the winter and the woman thinks, well, it's a witch's baby. What if the baby grows up to be a witch as well? Oh, yeah. Or what if the witch comes back and wants her baby? Not quite sure about this. And well, you know, the money I'm getting, it doesn't really cover what the baby, the baby's always crying. And so what they would do is they would wrap the baby up and they would go for a walk, maybe up in the Eildon Hills in the Borders or along the Ettrick and Yarrow Valley. And they would just keep walking until they found a quiet little spot, perhaps beside a tree or beside a little burn somewhere. And they would strip the baby naked, lie it down on the ground and walk away and allow the baby to die of exposure, because who wants a witch baby? And they would go back to the village and nobody would say anything. Nobody would notice that the baby was no longer there. But let's say I'm in my cell and I'm not pregnant. How do I get pregnant? None of my family's coming anywhere near me to help me out. The guard will help me. Yep, that's it. I'll bat my eyelashes at the guard and he's bound to help me. But no, he's not. Because it's a well-known fact that witches can shrivel your manhood. So there are very, very, very few cases of a guard ever helping a witch out. But let's say I wasn't arrested for being a witch. Let's say I was a man and I'd been accused of being a witch. Well, when I'm accused of being a witch as a woman, everybody goes, oh yeah, that's Mary, she's a witch. I'm instantly arrested, instantly dragged off. If I'm a man, I'll turn around and say, how dare you? How dare you accuse me of being a witch? Who says I'm a witch? And by sheer dint of your gender, you're above suspicion. How dare you? Who says I'm a witch? And often in cases where accusations were made against men, the accusation was dropped at that stage. And the person who'd made the accusation, if it was a woman, could often be in trouble and be done for slander. But even if you say, well, actually, we've got a bit of evidence, you know, we do think you're a witch, men would say, well, that's fine, but you're not putting me in the jail. I will stay at home. And they were put under house arrest. And this is an interesting wee point. There weren't very many men accused of being witches, but most of those that were managed to get house arrest. And this is when you end up with lots of suicides. Because if you're a man and you are executed as a witch, your entire estate is forfeit to the church. So your wife and your children are left destitute. But if you die as a suicide, you will be denied Christian burial, but your wife and your family will keep the house, will keep the business, will keep whatever land you had. And so often for male witches, you will find there will be a suicide. And that's what will be done. And then often you will find that the family will then get as much money as they can to go back into the Privy Council, if possible, and get names removed from some of the records. So the names are scratched out, so your reputation is safe. So that was where it was very different for those that were accused when they were men. But I'm a woman, I'm not pregnant, I've got no chance, and it comes around to October and they say, right, it's time for you. You're going to meet your maker. So you're taken out of my cell and I am barefoot and bareheaded to be penitent. I've got a sort of hair shirt on and a noose is put around my neck and my hands are tied behind my back. And I am walked from the jail up to the execution point. The minister is there and the congregation is there and they have to be there because, you see, the devil is a liar. He's a well-known liar. And he has to be shown to be a liar, because if the devil is so great and the devil is so powerful, then surely he's going to rescue me at the last minute. And so it has to be seen that he doesn't rescue me. So I am dragged all the way up, where I will then be worried to death, which is strangled, and then my dead body burnt. Now, you were supposed to be strangled to death and then your body burnt, but I'm not convinced that happened in every case. There was a trial in 1629 in Peebles where 24 people were executed on the same day. Now, I don't care how big and how strong the executioner was, who was usually a local blacksmith or a ploughman. I don't care how strong you are. It takes a long time to strangle someone to death. Staring someone full in the face and strangling them takes time. So by the time they got to the 24th person, I'm not sure they were dead before they were burnt. Well, let's say you are. That's it. Your body's burnt and off you go. And hopefully the wind will pick up and take your ash and you're away. The last trial and the last execution in the Scottish borders took place in 1700. And it was an old lady called Meg Lawson. And her case is quite interesting because this was her second conviction for witchcraft. The first one had been years earlier when presumably she'd been young enough and pretty enough for the judges to just let her off with a whipping. But 1700, she's an old lady and she's accused of laying illness on a child and she's found guilty and she's put in the toll booth in Selkirk and she's due for execution. Well, something happened and, you know, the congregation at Selkirk are sitting around waiting for the execution and it didn't happen. So they had an ale or two or three. By the time she was brought out of the toll booth, they were so drunk and so raucous, the minister was just glaring at them. But anyway, off we go. So old Meg is dragged along through Selkirk and she falls at one point. She fell at the Brigport and she's a poor old lady at this point. She says, oh, water, water. And the executioner says, nah, the drier you are, the better you'll burn. Well, the crowd's loving this. This is a great afternoon's entertainment. They're roaring and laughing. The minister's glowering at them. You know, this is supposed to be a solemn occasion. This is supposed to be condemning one of Old Nick's own to the flames, as it were. And here's the crowd having a good time. So he's not too happy about this. Anyway, they drag poor old Meg to her feet, drag her up the hill. And they get to the execution point. She's tied to the stake and the minister steps forward to speak to her. She says something, and nobody's quite sure exactly what she said. Nobody quite heard it. But the minister, and takes a step back. Again, the crowd are roaring. They think this is a great day out. So the executioner stands forward, and he strangled poor old Meg. Didn't take long. There wasn't much left in her old body. Then they can't get the pyre to light. Oh, for goodness sake. So they're trying and trying. And finally, there's a gust of wind, and it lifts, and the fire roars into life. And old Meg pulls, her head falls back, all her grey hair going out in the wind, and everybody sort of gasps. And at this point, the minister turns to start shouting at the congregation, and they start shouting back. It's practically a rammy, a riot's taking place. People start throwing things. At one point, a neat turnip, for those of you that aren't Scots, a neat goes whizzing past the minister's ear. Well, that's it, he turns tail and walks. Apparently, he went home that night and said, he wrote to the presbytery and said, I will take any parish in Scotland, even in Glasgow, as long as you get me away from the drunks in Selkirk. So a great day out for all concerned, except for old Meg, of course. Now, although old Meg's execution becomes a bit of a black farce, it was really the beginning of the end for the witchcraft trials. The proof that was starting to be introduced into courts, the philosophical arguments over, you know, are we really listening to the gossip of women? Is this really a thing? Starts to change. And by the time you get into the 18th century, the wars have petered out, the weather's better, there isn't so much famine, there isn't so much plague, the political situation is a lot more stable. And so the accusations start to ease off. But what's interesting is when you go into the 18th century, by the end of the 18th century, superstition, oh, it's all rubbish from the year before. And yet in the late 18th century, the divines of the Kirk of Scotland meet for the General Assembly, and they still reiterate their belief in witchcraft and witches. When you get into the 19th century, Walter Scott wrote a book on demonology and witchcraft. And it was various different sort of tales he'd collected from the borders. And there was one tale in particular that he thought was quite interesting. And it was a tale of a farmer who'd been walking down the road somewhere in the borders. And an old lady had passed him, and she'd cursed him. I mean, vehemently cursed him, to the extent where he actually got quite frightened. And he went to the local sheriff and said to the local sheriff, that old so-and-so, that old witch down there cursed me. And the sheriff said, well, she would do. She's a witch. The sheriff, the farmer, and the old lady were quite comfortable with the fact that she was a witch. As far as Sir Walter Scott was concerned, that story took place as late as 1830. So for those of you that think, well, that's been a very nice talk, Mary, but that was then and this is now, think on this. How many of you sitting, listening to me now, either do this yourself or have friends that do it? You'll throw salt over your left shoulder to blind the devil. You'll touch wood because you're touching the Holy Cross to keep the devil away from you. And how many of you lads picked up your bride and carried her over the threshold to stop the devil nipping her ankles? So the 17th century was not that long ago, and who knows, maybe old Nick's still out and about trying to get us. Thank you.
Mary, that, I'm never very, very normally speechless, but that was absolutely brilliant. Coming from the Scottish borders as well, it's been great. We've got time for questions and answers. I'm joined by my colleague, Joe, just now. I know we've been WhatsApping through your talk, and we've loved every minute. I've written down a couple of absolute classic one-liners. Putting slippers in the microwave made me hoot. Witches shrivel your manhood. Brilliant. There is one question that has come up. Why is the devil called Old Nick, Mary?
I'm not quite sure, but in Scotland it comes from Nicholas. And I'm not quite sure why Nicholas has became Old Nick. I mean, he was old because he was as old as Christ, obviously, but why Nicholas? I actually don't know. I'm not sure. He had a variety of names in Scotland. Old Clutty. So there were two or three names for him, but I have to, sorry, that one, I don't know the answer to that one.
Not at all. Joe, over to you for the next question.
Yeah, sure. I think my favourite line you said, Mary, was throwing a neep at a minister, which made me laugh quite a lot. Can't imagine that one. So the first question comes from Claire Fitzgerald. So thank you so much, Claire, for tuning in. And she's asked, where can we find copies of the records of the trials that you mentioned earlier on in your talk?
The first place, or the best first place to go, is the Scottish Witchcraft Survey, which you can find online. It was done by Edinburgh University and it has collated all the material into a very searchable database. And if you go into that database, it will give you the record numbers, and you can then go to the National Records of Scotland and they will show you those trial records. And very interesting they are too.
Fantastic, I imagine they are. Kenny.
Yeah, Mary, the next question is, I hear Scottish witches are quite often linked to a belief in fairies. Is this true?
Yes. Human belief is very long standing. If you go into the pre-Christian era, people believed in supernatural beings and they believed in the fairies, and a lot of people still believe in fairies to this day. So a lot of the people that we think of as witches actually believed in the little people. They believed in fairies who would help them with charms. And this, as I say, is long-standing. It started off in the pagan era. When the Christians came along, Christianity came along, and Scotland became a Christian country, but alongside the belief in God was the belief in the fairies. The two of them ran alongside each other for ages, and it was only in the 17th century when the church started to become obsessed with the devil that they sort of put devil worship and worship of the fairies, or belief in the fairies, all together in the one pot. But previously, it was the Kirk that was obsessed with the devil, not anybody else. Belief in the fairies was belief in the fairies, and there are still people that believe in the fairies to this day. So it was a long-standing belief in little people that might help you if you were nice to them.
Wonderful, thank you. Joe, next question.
Yeah, thank you very much. So our next question is, what extent do you think that communities believed these women really were witches, or was this more of a tool to keep the community in line?
It was a bit of both. Mm-hmm. For the authorities, it was a way of keeping people in line. For the authorities, it was a way of making sure that people did what they were supposed to do. You were supposed to believe the right things. You were supposed to go to church and believe in God, not believe in fairies at the bottom of your garden. So there was that. But people genuinely did think they had powers, that, you know, you had some people who were herbalists, who were cunning women, who knew how to help women through childbirth or help children through illness. And they genuinely thought themselves to be part of that supernatural world. So they might not have used the word witch in the sense that we think of it as, you know, bad witches or good witches or whatever, but there was a belief that they were witches, that people did have power. Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, you're living in a land where the minister tells you that Christ has power. Well, if Christ has power, and the devil has power, and if you follow Christ, or you follow the devil, or you follow little people, you can, if you are very fortunate, have some of that power yourself, or you're able to wield some of that power. So yes, there were witches who believed they were witches. One of the best was Isabel Gowdy, who was Queen of the Witches. She was known as Queen of the Witches, and she's from up north near Inverness. And when she was arrested and interviewed, and they said, you know, it's terrible, you're a witch. And she went, I forbid, I'm a witch, what of it? And they sort of thought, what? She wasn't ashamed about this at all. And she says, oh yeah, she says, I've been to see the Queen of the Fairies. And she gave me meat. And I saw the King of the Fairies. Oh, he was a handsome big lad, you know, and I danced at his wedding. Oh aye, but you'll never see them because you're a fool. And they were really upset about the fact that Isabel Gowdy was not ashamed of the fact that she was a witch at all.
She sounds great.
She was great fun. Isabel, yeah. More Gowdies in the world, that's what we need.
Absolutely. Kenny.
Yeah, that kind of sort of brings me on to the question that Russell Clegg has asked from Edinburgh. Thanks, Russell, for joining us. Russell's asking, what other cases did you uncover in your research? And did any other differ distinctly from the documented cases in Edinburgh, East Lothian and Fife?
Most of the witchcraft trials fall into two categories. It's either somebody that's old and poor and on the margins, and that's been a quarrel, or somebody's become ill and there's a genuine belief that they are a witch. And then there are another whole sort of, maybe about a quarter of the trials where you can tell it's somebody who's just trying to get out their neighbour or have an argument with their neighbour. That is definite. The trials that you get up in Edinburgh tend to be the more serious trials simply because it's the capital. And so if you have trials involving somebody with a little bit of status, for example, there was a trial with Lady Manderson in Duns, and she was able, because she had family members who were on the Privy Council, she was able to get her trial moved up to Edinburgh, where she knew she would get a fairer trial. So a lot of the trials in Edinburgh involve people who are of middle status or slightly into the sort of landed gentry type status. So there is a slight change there. There's often, and also with Edinburgh, with it being coastal, you would get a lot of trials about witches causing storms to sink ships. So there are slight differences up there, but it's not markedly one area was a different type of trial. It was just that there seemed to be a greater proliferation in the borders, probably because they were so close to England.
Thanks, Miriam. And thanks for mentioning Duns, my hometown. That's really good. Joe, next question for you.
Yeah, absolutely. So Mary, N. Jones, who is one of our lovely colleagues, hello Non, is asking, when was the earliest documented witch trial in Scotland?
Oh, flip. That would be in the 16th century, because there were some early ones. I mean, there's the famous North Berwick ones, obviously, in 1590s. But I think the earliest documented case where it actually goes through the courts as opposed to the church courts is about 1570. But in these earlier ones in the 16th century, what you get is you get people being... they're maybe whipped, they're maybe branded, they're maybe excommunicated. They weren't sentenced to death. It was only in the 17th century. But there are some very early 16th century ones, yes.
It's amazing how quickly that all ramped up then, isn't it? Within such a short space of time.
Yeah.
Kenny.
Yeah, thanks, Jo. Mary, the next question comes from Lisa Cowan. Lisa, thanks for joining us this afternoon. Lisa lives in Newstead near Melrose, and she's just asking, what other places in the borders were known for witch accusations?
Oh, right. Well, Stow, where I am, there were 6 witches executed in Stow. Peebles, there were 27 in one trial in 1629. You've got trials in Gattonside, Galashiels, Selkirk, Hoyk, Kelso, Jedburgh, Duns, Eyemouth, Coldingham. I'm actually thinking it would be easier for me to go through the towns and the borders where there were witch trials. There were witches associated with practically every single town and village in the borders. Absolutely. And round about Melrose, Gatton, Melrose, Newstead, that area, yes, a lot of them there. A lot of witch activity there. Wherever you get a lot of farmland, you're going to get it, which, of course, is the whole of the borders. So, yeah.
Great, thanks. Joe, over to you.
Thank you. So, our next question is, just looking for a particularly juicy one. So, Peter has asked, how many trials are we talking about, and did the numbers change over time?
Okay, during that 100-year period, there were about 4,000 trials.
Wow.
The population of Scotland at that time was about 1 million.
My goodness.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
So we had one of the highest per capita rates of trial and execution anywhere in Europe. We had 10 times the number of trials and executions as they had in England. During the same period of time in Ireland, they had 4 trials. 4 in the entire 100 years. There's a letter, and I think it was written in Bavaria in the middle of the century, where a local burgomaster wrote to the minister and said, we should be dealing with witches the way they do in Scotland, because they really know how to deal with them over there. So yeah, a very, very high percentage of trials and executions. Almost all of the trials in Scotland led to execution.
Mm-hmm. And most of them would have been women as well, I would imagine.
About 85% women, 15% men. But that was standard for most of Europe, except in the Scandinavian countries, where it flipped around the other way for a very strange reason. The Scandinavian countries said that the reason most witches would be men is because if the devil really wanted to attack people, he wouldn't use stupid women, he would use men. So that was a Scandinavian backhanded compliment to women, if you like.
The only time misogyny has been helpful.
Indeed.
Kenny.
We've got a question from Romy. Basically, why the borders, Mary? I know you're saying that it was land and everything, but surely there was land in the highlands and everything like that. So why particularly the borders?
It's interesting you mentioned the highlands. The highlands and islands had the least number of trials in Scotland, and that's because they had the highest proportion of people who remained Catholic. The problem with the borders was that it was neither one thing nor the other. The north of England had remained Catholic, so they literally had Catholics on their doorstep. And that's what terrified the Borders Kirk. And there was also a long-standing antagonism with Edinburgh, which went way back to a good 200 or 300 centuries before, which is a very long, very long story. So the Borders felt itself abandoned by Edinburgh, but with Catholics on its doorstep. And there was also the fact that during this period, of course, you had the Covenanters who rose during the Civil War, and they actually rode out and physically fought for the faith. The Borders clergy didn't. The Borders was the area in Scotland that had the least number of Covenanters. So the Borders clergy were talking a good game. Oh, yes, we're defenders of the faith, and we're great, and we're fantastic, and we're Calvinist. But when push came to shove, they didn't fight. So if they didn't fight physically, they had to fight in another way. So psychologically, they were looking for that fight. And so what they did was they fixated on the devil. And of course, it doesn't take much for one or two things to happen for it to build up a momentum of its own. When you're in Edinburgh, there's other things going on in the town, or if you're in Glasgow, or if you're in Aberdeen. But in the borders, there was nothing else. It was the only game in town. And so that's why once you get into that mindset of everybody's out to get me, then everything that happens proves that everybody's out to get you.
Great, thanks for that. We've still got a few more questions. Joe, over to you for the next one.
Cool, thank you. So next question comes from Karen. She's asking, how do you feel about the way we teach children, particularly girls, about witchcraft nowadays?
It's an interesting one because there is a difference between talking about witchcraft and witch belief and talking about the witchcraft trials. As I always say, I don't teach about witchcraft. I know what the beliefs were, and I know where the beliefs came from, and that they came from the supernatural, and that you could call on these beings for help. But I think we need to be very careful in what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And I know that there are modern witches, and they are very protective of their faith, so they have a whole other area that they're coming from. I think what we need to be teaching children is, well, it says me that's not a teacher, teaching them that different beliefs exist in different times, and the way we treated those different beliefs has changed over time, and showing them as much of the evidence as you can, depending on the age group, obviously, and then teaching them to investigate for themselves and think about it themselves and think about whether or not they thought this was fair. And I'm not defending the Kirk, but I can understand how they got into that mindset of thinking, oh no, we're under attack, we need to do something. You know, if you genuinely think you're under attack, then you're going to react in a certain way. So that's not to excuse them, but it does explain why they reacted. It's the step from religious zeal to religious frenzy is a very short step. Mm-hmm. It's a very short step. And we've seen, and it happens frequently in history. If you look at the 1930s Germany, you had people under stress, and the authorities told them it was the Jews, and all of a sudden the Jews were picked on. So these things are very important to look at in case we start repeating them.
Yeah,
absolutely. Great question.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, there's some really good questions coming in, everybody. Thank you so much for sending them in. We'll try and get through as many as we can. Next one is from Angela, and Angela asks, I'm currently studying this at college and loving it. If you're a pagan, are you a witch? Are they the same thing?
Ah, now there's a question. Do you mean now or in the 17th century? I've no idea now. In the 17th century, there wouldn't have been anybody who would have classed themselves as pagan. That's a modern label that we put on people. People believed what they believed. And they were told if they were Christian, they were I'll give you a very quick example. People were Catholic and then the Reformation happened. So one day you're Catholic and the next day the Reformation's happened and you're Protestant. What you believe is still what you believe. You still believe that there is God, you still believe in angels, or you still believe in the Madonna, but all of a sudden the label has changed. So it's a difficult one. You could be a witch and a Christian at the same time, because again, it's going back to this belief in the fairies. People did not see that that you couldn't believe in both. Why couldn't you believe in both? Why can't I be a Christian and go to the kirk on a Sunday and listen to the minister telling me about Auld Nick, but when I go for a walk on the hills and I see a fairy ring, I will leave cheese and milk for the fairies? But people didn't put labels on things and they didn't see a difference. The established church did. The kirk absolutely thought it was not on to believe both. But most folk believed the two together and didn't label themselves as pagan or heathen. You weren't actually considered a heathen because you were following Satan, if this makes sense. So in the Christian church, you have God and you have the devil, and you've decided to follow the devil instead of God, which is bad. But you're not a heathen. A heathen would be, for example, somebody who was Jewish or somebody who was Muslim or somebody who was Sikh. They would be heathen because they would be out with the Christian. They would be out with the Christian family. It's nicely complicated, and for most folk in the 17th century, made absolutely no sense whatsoever. They just believed what they believed.
Great, thanks, Mary. We've got time for a couple more questions. So, Joe, over to you for maybe the penultimate question.
Indeed, oh, the penultimate question is going to have to be a good one then in that case. They've all been good so far. So what happened to John Kincaid? Did he have a taste of his own medicine?
Oh, yes, he did. What a brilliant question. John Kincaid ended up in the jail. John Kincaid got arrested. Oh, flipping, I can't remember when. I think it was about 1660. He got arrested and he was put in the Edinburgh toll booth for brooding witches without the required warrant. So he was chucked in the jail and everybody was very, very upset at him. And then they realised that there were a load of accusations came in that he had been brooding people, and some of them had been sort of, you know, damaged beyond belief. And a couple of people were alleged to have died, and all these accusations were being brought against him. And he was there for maybe about 3 days, and then he paid a £1,000 Scots bail, which is massive, and they let him off, gave him a slap on the wrist, and he said, I promise the next time I go out brooding, I'll have the correct licence with me, and that was it. Nothing happened to him, really, but he did spend a couple of days in jail. There were other witch brooders, one of whom was hanged in Durham. He was a Scotsman. But yeah, so John Kincaid did end up in jail. But the people that he had brooded without the warrant, nothing was done about that. They weren't given any compensation. There were no apologies. What had upset the Privy Council was that he'd done so without the proper authority. That was what had upset them.
All about paperwork, eh?
Yeah, oh, absolutely, yeah.
Mary, I'm going to have to ask the last question here. There's still a lot of people out there want to ask questions. So I think what we're going to have to do is bring this one to a close, but I really do think we're going to have to invite you back to the library for more witch stories, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, happy to come and chat to you.
I'm happy to listen to you. Catherine Small asks, and I'm hoping we can finish on a positive note here, are there any, or indeed many, cases of people being being found in?
There were a few, not many, not a lot at all, but there were a few who were found not guilty. There was Elizabeth Bathgate from Eyemouth, and Elizabeth Bathgate was involved in quite a complicated case up in Eyemouth, where she was accused of sinking somebody's ship and causing somebody's horse to go lame and causing somebody else's horse to go mad. And she was arrested along with three or four others, and they were all put in the jail in Eyemouth. And Elizabeth Bathgate was savvy enough, and she had a little bit of money, and she got herself a lawyer. And the lawyer stood up in court and just ripped everybody to shreds and just completely made a fool of everybody. And all the charges were dropped, and Elizabeth Bathgate walked a free woman.
What a great, exactly, what a great way to end the talk on a positive note. Mary, I can only say it's pouring with rain outside my flat, but boy, have you really brightened up my afternoon. It's been so good. Thank you so much for such an interesting and engaging talk. I hope everybody at home enjoyed it half as much as Joe and myself did.
That's been great. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me, and thank you everybody who came along to listen.